Jamali 9000.
I literally drink every month or two. Like I drink at my club night, and I drink when we do the drunk casts. Mm. But because I do drunk podcasts every now and then, everyone thinks I'm a massive drinker. But I went off it a few years back.
Yeah, for some reason, in my mind, I thought you were straight edge. And I don't know why I had that. I know you do the drunk podcast, like
drunk cards.
But you know, like, would you ever a big drinker?
I used to be a big drinker. Like, one of the reasons I do another podcast called Say Why to Drugs with Dr. Susie Gage.
Which is great.
Yeah, it's because she's a doctor that's an expert in all the drugs. And I've done most of the drugs, but don't anymore.
Yeah.
So it's one of them. I'm kind of a perfect person because I've not got a horse in the race anymore. Yeah. I'm not like, always the best. I'm not into anything, but
why did you slow down with the older?
It's
just not for you no more.
It's a theme that comes across my life, man. It went so well. Why I stopped.
Yeah,
I had a really good time on all the drugs I ever did, and I know a lot of people who had a really bad time on most of the drugs at some point I'd done. So I kind of went, this is a good time to say goodbye to this drug. My only experiences have been fun, so I'll step off now and keep it like
and
that.
And you have the good memory of it.
Yeah, it's similar with touring and doing music. I stopped doing music after my most successful album, my biggest tour, and my last gig was one of the biggest crowds I've ever had, of about 10 to 15,000 at best of all.
Fuck.
And I stopped then because I was like, it's a good point to stop that.
Did you see that as the
I'm
peak?
Liking it.
Did you see that as the peak?
Yeah,
was there something that's in you that was like, this is the peak? And then, you know, you're probably performing every song.
Combination of the two, yeah. Had been touring at least 100 gigs a year for 10 years. And I'd enjoyed every gig and put everything into it. But I felt I was at that point of it about to tip to not enjoying it anymore. So I was like, right, this is an amazing one to go out on. And again, I might go back to it at some point if I've got some new songs and stuff like that. But it is that thing of if you've done, as I said, averages out at over 100 gigs a year, and that's in
people don't
England,
how much that,
America, Japan, all everywhere in Europe.
What's Japan like?
I only did one gig there at a festival, and it was an hour-long set, ended up being 45 minutes long, because you realise how much time you spend on banter in between songs and chat. And in Japan, they ain't up for that. So every time they'd go, I'd be like, they'd cheer, and they'd be like, how you doing? This is it. And they'd just...
No, they wouldn't hear the tunes.
And I was just like... play the next song, Dan. And you realise our set just shrunk by a quarter.
You're doing archive tunes.
Yeah, exactly.
You're breaking out of your chest.
And that was after, I think we'd only had one album out at that point. So it's like, there's nothing extra that we can do. We did our album and a couple of covers.
You versus Dan the
set? Yeah, it was me and Dan. But you realise quite quick how much you rely on that interaction and intimacy.
Yeah, for real.
And all of a sudden, if that's not there, you're just like, just play the songs and go home.
People don't realise, man, like, it's because you say to some people, I'm doing 100 gigs a year, and they go, only 100? That tour, man, just drain you out.
It adds up, and it's killer, and it's all the travel as well. As I said, there were certain years, because that's with writing albums and stuff as well. So in that, it's weird, because we recently had the 10-year anniversary of our first album, of mine and Dan's
first
album coming out. No, we didn't, because again, I just stopped.
You won't even come out of retirement
That's my last gig at the moment. That's perfect. I can't top that. Even
because people must ask you all the time when you're rapping again.
Yeah,
that's the main.
Constantly,
it's that one more match.
I just did
Terry Funk.
I just did it. Yeah, exactly like that. I just did a limited run of the most offensive merch I've ever done, which was just Make Pip Rap Again hats in the Trump Make America Great Again style.
That's funny.
So I did a limited run because this is quite exploitative and offensive and horrible. But
that's like
it is, again, no matter what you do, podcasts every week, films, TV, anything you're doing, the first comment would be, are you going to tour anytime soon? Or have you got no music on the way? No. If I had a kid and posted saying, here's my child, the first comment would be, you're going to do any new music soon? You'd be like, man.
Yeah, I've got my baby in my arms. They're like, yeah, we like that, but you're going to create a new album. But I mean, it's not beautiful in that people still want to hear. People want to hear? Cause I remember, do you know what the funny thing is? Is like, I haven't accomplished much in my career, but the little I've accomplished, my uncle's never impressed. My uncle's just like, But when he found out that I knew you, he was like, shut up, you don't know Scroobius Pip. I said, I know Scroobius Pip. You don't fucking know him. Like, I had to show him a photo of us together.
Genuinely, I always get the same off Ramesh. Ramesh Ranganathan, he's done everything. Yeah. He's so successful. He's like, the kids he used to teach at school, is like, all he gets from him is every week or two, someone will find out that he knows me and be like, yeah. And again, it's that weird because I'm not that known, but those, again, I've always I've always hated the term underrated, and a lot of rappers and a lot of people like that bounce it about, and I think it does a disservice to those who rate you. Because the people who do rate me, I adore how much, it blows my mind that they're as into it as they are. So to say I'm underrated just because the pop charts aren't as into it anymore or whatever else is kind of, it feels insulting to my, my people.
Yeah, I understand the statement of underrated. Yeah. I think and a lot of people who say underrated are the people who love you.
Because they're like,
I love this thing so much.
Yeah. More people.
And you don't like it, it's underrated. Because I rate it. Do you know what I'm saying? So I don't understand what you're saying, though. It goes both ways. It's kind of, it does take away from the fact of, like, you know, there's people that do rate you.
Yeah.
And to say, like, oh, they like me, but I want all these other people to like me that don't know me. But at the same time, it's like, sometimes I find it's the fans of people. I remember when I first heard your stuff, because my uncle, I was growing a beard out, he goes, you're going to look like Scroobius Pip. And I was like, I didn't know who Scroobius, and I was young, I was like, who's Scroobius Pip? And then he had it on his phone.
Yeah.
And he played it, and it was just this mad thing. It was like, it was like spoken word, but rapping and on these crazy beats.
Yeah.
And it was dope as fuck. And it is that thing of, you know, it's interesting how you sort of had this style, but put it into the hip hop world and still maintained who you were.
Yeah.
Because you hear that song Thou Shout.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You're saying a whole bunch of references that, you know, what people say hip hop head wouldn't know.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying? You're talking about bands like the Pixies and the, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, dude, bands I didn't know.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying? I was just like, fuck, and it made me go out and research these bands.
Yeah.
But you still had the placement in hip hop. Do you know what I'm saying, though? And it felt like you had a respect for the culture as well. Because, do you know what I'm saying? It didn't feel like, oh, it's just someone pretending to. Like, it felt like, oh, this dude's doing some hip hop shit.
100%.
But doing it
man,
his way.
It's about the respect of the culture. And it's weird because I came up in spoken word. But I came up in spoken word because I live in a small town in Essex that didn't have producers. Stanford Lee Hope. I still live there. I've lived the same place my whole life.
Why do you still live there?
It keeps me aware that the world isn't all right. As stupid as that sounds, it's an area it's small town Essex. There's small town mentality. There's racism. There's homophobia. There's loveliness as well, but there's those things. And I think as soon as I started to get successful, I was tempted to move into London. It was at the time that I was gigging a lot with like Kate Nash and Jack Peñar, and all these all seemed to be in this same area. And if I'd moved into London then, I would have easily started to think, oh, the world's so beautiful and loving, and everyone's creative and artist. But I'd do a gig. I always remember the highlight one for me. I did spoken word at the Shepherd's Bush Empire before Stuart Lee did comedy, Steve Coogan did comedy, The Cure played a song. It was this big collaborative gig. Yeah, it was this huge thing. And then I got the train home, and on the way home, I got called a terrorist by a drunk. I had some girls from Tilbury try and set fire to my beard and steal my shoes. Because it was the Friday night train home, the vomit comet. So
vomit comet.
So it was just, it's that kind of thing that just, I don't know, I think it keeps you humble, it keeps you aware that the world isn't fixed yet. And again, like we've seen in recent years with Brexit, with Trump, with all of that, as soon as we get comfy of everyone's lovely and loving and in the right way of mind, you go, you have a really harsh reminder that that's not the
case. Why do you want to be based in that? Why do you want to have a base in that reality?
What is it
that drive? Because the thing is, like, you know, I'm sure you have a good living and stuff, but I'm saying, like, what's the question I'm asking here? What is it about that? Because it is, and it's very true what you're saying. Like, and I agree with 100% what you're saying. Like, I right now I'm back in the ends that I grew up, and it gave me a reality check because I was in LA filming for a bit, and you can get into this whole world of like, oh my god, everyone's great.
I love it.
You have like your top down, and you're living life, and then I go back and I'm seeing, you know, poverty.
Yeah,
and I go, oh my, you know what I'm saying? But what is it about that? Why do you choose to keep?
I think it's important on two things. It's important for keeping you humble, for knowing where you are, and you know, being in that same area, or three things really. There's the artistic choices of that, and being a writer. If you're writing and creating, you need to be surrounded by the real world, not by a bubble of a world. I think it's why. Again, the fact is, I'm really proud that our most successful album of kind of like first week sales or whatever else was our last album. In general, a lot of bands get successful, particularly if they come from rougher areas, and then their music gets diluted because they're suddenly they're living an amazing life and everything's happy. So it's good to have that. But on the third point, legit just going down to a practicality, when I was touring a lot, I was doing, you know, a decent amount of gigs every week. I was home for a month or two each year. So if you're only home for that much, number one,
You're paying $2,000 of rent.
Yeah, why pay London rates?
Yeah,
number two, when you're home, you want to feel at home. You want to know the local takeaways and where the shop is and where the past midnight spots are and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like if you move to a new place,
drink a pint and chill out.
Exactly. So that was it. Every time I went to move, I was like, mate, if I move, I'm going to be, the brief times I'm not on tour, I'm going to be, feel like I'm away from home anyway. It'll take me years to feel like I'm home because I'm not there enough.
Well, you see, when you quit the rap music,
yeah,
I felt like a really old person when I said that. When you quit the rap, but when you quit spitting bars, was you already transitioning to doing the podcast?
I just started the podcast. I'd been doing a radio show.
So you had something else that you were going to transition to then.
Well, that was it. It was a choice to transition into acting. I wanted to give acting a go. I always directed all my own music videos, and they're all quite theatrical.
Yeah,
good, it was Simon Pegg and Riz Ahmed, actually, who are the two who always said to me, you know, you're already acting. Like, you know, when you're on stage and you're doing that angry song, you know, you're not really angry. Mm. And you know, when you do that sad song, you know, you're not really sad. They're like, that's acting. And they kind of encouraged me to give it a go. And the plan was to try it for a year or so and see how it worked. And I did the same with music. I was working in a record store for 5 years. I was saving up to put out an album. And I saved up and I quit my job just as I'd got to kind of a manager point, because it was that thing of, I was like, right, either I have to admit I work in retail and that's it, or I do music properly.
Which is a hard choice.
Yeah, and again, I loved working in retail. I loved my mates there. I had some good friends. So it wasn't like, oh, this is terrible. But I thought, I need to give it a full go. So I quit my job and I'd saved enough to live for a year. I was kind of living in my van at the time and like for touring the country. I'd recorded an album and I'd pressed them. And then I quit and went out and just toured the country just doing gigs on street corners and things like that. It's mad. It was only when I did a podcast recently, I realised that when I did that, I'd never performed live. So that's some, you could call it confidence or you could call it just ignorance.
How old were you?
I was in my 20s. I was 23 or 24.
Yeah, but when you're young, man.
Yeah.
You just,
I'd recorded an album and I'd worked on it and I'm proud of this. Mm. And it's the one bit of advice, like, I often have people ask me for feedback on music and that, and I'm always like, I'm rubbish at that because I never had it myself. I just wrote what I liked. But my one bit of advice is always, if you're excited for people to hear it, it's probably where you need it to be. So I quit that job and I said I got in my 1987 Space Cruiser.
Ballin.
That had it was gold. The seats fold down at the back to make a double bed.
There you go.
It was the one.
And double bed as well. That's how you know you're living life.
Exactly. I toured about the country just doing kind of street corner gigs. I learned quickly that the town centre has got a lot of people, but not necessarily a lot of people who want to hear rap or hip hop or whatever else. Because I was beatboxing into a loop pedal and rapping over the top. Again, the reason I started doing spoken word is because I didn't have anyone to make beats. Mm. I got into spoken word after that, but I started doing this because I like rap. It was rap.
And you was looping with the beatbox.
I was looping with the beatbox on a loop pedal, which is
now, if you go down Central London,
there
you cannot move for beatbox. But this beatbox is fucking everywhere.
Yeah,
where's the fascination with beatbox in the last? Because it's like,
it's mad, isn't it?
You see it in like
because I'm not that into
TV.
It myself.
Oh my god, it's fucking terrible. But you know, you see white people standing there
really
taking
good
photos.
I mean,
great,
you know,
Faith FFX, and there were some great ones. But then like now, it's just, there seems to be beatboxers fucking. I got Central London. And it's just a dubstep beatboxer.
Yeah.
And it's people. It's
terrible. Kind of cool because it's like, they can do it off their own back. And
no, listen, I respect the hustle, man. If you want to get it in like that, you get it in like that. And they're making money.
Because you've got them tourist people outside
Eminem world going crazy.
Yeah.
But at the same time, man, like, I watch that and I go, I don't want to hear another jungle remix. Of a beatbox. But
and
you
that's
say
it.
You
would, it's that kind of thing. It's that. It's always weird because I have it the same with beatboxing and freestyling, and I've offended people in the past because there's been bands who've supported us who have a beatboxer or a freestyler, but I'm not like the live gig freestyling where it's take something out of your pocket, all that. I respect it, but I think it's
that supernatural.
I think it's cabaret. Like, I don't mean that as an insult. I honestly don't mean it as an insult.
You mean it's a party piece?
Yeah, it's a party piece. It's like, I don't want to hear an album of someone doing that and things like, do you know what I mean? So it's got its place. I remember a beatbox who was like there was a beatbox who was in a band who supported us for a while, and he went on X Factor and did quite well, and there was a lot of backlash from people saying, oh, you've sold out and gone on that. It's like, that's what it's always been. It's always been, look at what I can do.
Because there's no real progression for the beatboxer.
Yeah, what's the dude going to do? Again, a beatbox and album. A few have done it, but it's a hard thing to pull off.
And the ones that have done it have been a bit,
And the same with freestylers. Like, there's a lot of freestylers that don't, or battle rappers that don't transfer over to album.
He's a battle rapper.
You know?
He ain't got no fucking albums.
Again, it's tough though, but it's different skill sets. Yeah, it's like when people have that weird thing of going up to a comedian, or people in the industry be, oh, you're a comedian. Have you got any ideas for a sitcom?
No, it's not.
It's a different thing. It's the same with 100%. Freestyle, with album type raps and all that. But yes, so I realised quick that the city centres have got a lot of people, but not the people who want to hear it. Also, the last city centre I did was in Manchester, and people were literally circling me to rob my gear because I had just a speaker and the loop pedal and shit like that.
Yeah, them guys with the strap bags and the bucket hats.
I was like, right, I'm going to call this a day. But what I started doing then was, because me and my mate with me, we'd get to a town, and then it was before kind of as much internet or whatever else, we'd go and get a local gig listings and see who's playing, then go and perform outside their gig. Because my thought was, if they've got, I remember I did one outside a DJ Shadow gig, Buck 65 Atmosphere, all that kind of thing, Mr. Scruff. Because my thought was, they're going to get my target audience from that area and literally line them up against a wall. Quite literally.
Yeah.
So just, you're going to get a bit of hit rate. So I'd go there and perform and hand out some flyers and stuff
and
like that.
And be off from there.
Yeah. And go from there. And then, so I'd give myself a year, and a year almost to the day of quitting my job, A Thou Shalt came out and got in the top 40. And that was kind of the, I don't have to go back yet. Then.
And was you going to, and was that the
that
day?
Was the plan. If it didn't work out, the plan was
you
gonna to...
looking back on it now, and it's always a hard question because hindsight's a different thing. But do you think that, you say to the day, would you have gone back to retail like a week later?
Depends how much the money lasted, mate.
Yeah.
It's that, it's the realism
of
that.
Was you going down to money? Was you going down?
Yeah, I was going down. Again, I lived at home with my mum.
Yeah.
And... but again, she's always worked in libraries and stuff. It's not like we're a wealthy. Like, I've not had this horrible upbringing. It's been lovely, but it's not like we're wealthy ever. Or I was never in one of them families where you turn 18 and they buy you a car and stuff like that.
It's a reality based people working. People.
So that was it. It would have been a case of, and it was before. It's why I initially had a backlash against the whole Kickstarter thing, because I'd say at the time all the time, my Kickstarter campaign was working for 5 years and saving up.
Yeah.
That's how I put
Do you still not agree with Kickstarter?
No, I think it's right for the right projects and for the right things. There's certain areas of the industry that need more money and don't have it because it's not profitable, but it is artistically worth it. So I can understand that, and I can understand the focus. But for me at that point, it was a case of that. If I couldn't afford to keep doing music, I would have had to stop. And it's what happens a lot these days. Since music has gone disposable and free, there is a lot of artists who 5 years ago or 10 years ago might have been something great, but they've got bells to pay, man.
I find music like, because I can only relate it to my doing comedy.
Yeah.
I find music terrifying in terms of to make it as a musician. And you can correct me if I'm wrong. Because the thing is, my mentality is this. If I do comedy and I'm decent, I'll work.
You're not saying you'd be the
biggest comic ever, but you'll work. You know what I'm saying? You'll put a bit of money, you can probably pay some bills if you're good enough.
There's some
meritocracy to it. You could be done the best singers in the world, man, and never fucking go up. Like, you know what I'm saying? You can never blow up.
Yeah.
And that's a terrifying concept, you know?
I'm a really bad person to talk about any of these things because I think I've had a lot of luck in life. So Thou Shalt was my first ever single and it got in the charts, and then I toured the world for 5 years. I mean, so I'm like, it's easy.
You think it's
music
luck?
Industry is easy. You just record a song, put it out, it's easy. And then I started a podcast and it instantly blew up and we've had 12 million downloads. And then I stopped to try acting, and in the first year I did a Guy Ritchie film, a show on FX, and then a Tom Hardy
thing. Isn't your fucking life
on BBC? I was like
well, you know what, Pip, fuck you.
It's easy, but that's what's been exciting on the acting thing is these first few gigs came in. And again, I was like, I was nervous, and I worked hard at them. But on Taboo, I buddied up with Stephen Graham, and he was the best because he sat me down and said to me, it's going good now. This isn't the path it's going to continue to take. You've been really lucky so far, and you've hustled for it. Like, I'd got out there and done my thing to get these gigs. I didn't just sit back. I hit up.
That's what I'm going to call bullshit in terms of saying luck. Yeah. I think luck is a real humble. I mean, you know, you're a humble cat. You know what I'm saying? So I understand why you're saying that. But at the same time, bro, I don't know a lot of people sleeping in their cars.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying, though? Yeah. I don't know a lot of people.
You've got to put yourself in the position to have luck.
And you're going through a gig list and being like, yo, I'm going to go outside the atmosphere gig and I'm going to get my little loop pedal and I'm going to spit these bars. Do you know what I'm saying?
And like, it's mad. One of the guys who was outside the atmosphere gig, I think it was, or maybe the Buck 65 gig, 5 years later ended up producing a beat on my first proper solo record. Buddy Peace, who produces my website, was at that gig, or my podcast, sorry, was at that gig as well. So it is that mad shit that you might only have the effect on one or two people, but those people could affect you for the rest of your life. But yeah.
Was you ever on a major label?
No. We spoke to them all.
Yeah, I'm saying, when Thou Shalt come out, what happened?
So we were being courted by Warner and Sony and everyone, and we ignorantly
on the 360 deal,
on all sorts of deals. It was just as 360 deals were coming in, so it was just before it, really.
Yeah, because you're real, like, you know, I know you got the merch and you got the podcast. Like, you would do that, like, you know, you like do shit in the bed. You
actually business minded on it.
Yeah, you definitely influenced me. Like, you know, because I remember, like, when I was doing my t-shirts. And they were like, okay, we're going to get a car. I said, you know what? Nah, man. Like, and they were like, well, you're going to sit there and count your t-shirts. And I was like, well, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to count the sizes. I'm going to be out there selling it. You know what I'm saying? Because that's one of the things. That's one of the things that's different. What you can do, what other people can't do, and what I need to get a piece of, is that you actually go out there and you shake into people's hands.
Yeah. I remember the first time, or the only time I did the Edinburgh Fringe, I had Nick Helm come up to me and say, how do you do this? Because after the Fringe, I'd go straight to my merch booth and have my book there, some t-shirts, because I've done that from gigging from day one, that I'm there, I'll shake hands. If you want to just come and say hello, you can just say hello. But if you want something signed, you can buy stuff. And comedy isn't are used to that, and they feel uncomfortable and feel as if you're selling out or
merch,
being
we just do not merch. Yeah. Like in America they do.
In America,
you after a gig you see them there where they got their business cards, they got their CDs. It's only like, I think there was a little time, there was like a boom where everyone had CDs.
Yeah.
And then people would sell them after gigs. Yeah, but then that kind of died out. Yeah. And now you've got little USB cards. But there is a sort of thing in comedy, especially British comedy, about merching.
And a discomfort.
Yeah,
in doing it.
I think it's, you know, I don't know what it is, because we think we're two artists, or we kinda have this sort of nervousness about it. But you know, like when it comes to tour time, I mean, you know, not to make it all about me, but like I've sort of gone a lot smaller and I've gone a lot independent with my tour. So I'm doing it all off the own back. I've paid for all the venues myself. And it's one of the ways I'm going to do it now is I'm going to merch to make up the profit. So I go, okay, yeah, I will come to your town. And it might be a littler town, which I wouldn't normally play on tour. A lot of people miss on tour. And I'll go and I'll sell t-shirts or try and sell some books and stuff.
It makes bags of sense, man. Yeah. It's a win-win for everyone. I remember at one gig, someone saying to Dan, because Dan, after our gigs, I'd go to the merch table and Dan would go outside. So we'd both be able to meet people, but it wouldn't be too hectic. There'd be this split.
Yeah.
And I remember he was saying that someone was saying to him, oh, Pip, just there to sell extra merch. And I'm like, it's win-win. Like, we do sell merch if I'm on the merch booth, but equally, I remember going to see Sage Francis before I was rapping and buying an album I already had because he was doing the merch booth and I could meet him and get it signed and say, I love your music. So that meant the world to me. That was worth every penny.
Yeah.
So it's win-win. It doesn't have to be that one or the other.
I love... Come say hello.
Yeah, that's it. I love meeting everyone. Yeah, you don't have
to. You don't have to come buy a CD. I mean, I'm going to judge you, but...
Yeah, exactly. I'll give you some stick, but yeah.
Yeah, you got
to
buy
this. That. I love that. And it's people think that it has to be a one or the other. Like, if it benefits you in any way, then you're mugging people off. So no, it can benefit me and someone else, and it can benefit all of us, and it'd be
so we've got, so let's take a little step back then. Yeah. So you're getting caught by all these big labels.
So we went to,
and so if this is stuff you spoke, I know you probably spoke about this shit a million times.
I've spoken about it in ages. I kind of
I know you don't, because I mean, it's like same when, like when people ask me about my show, I fucking go,
or because,
like,
I
actually retired it on your show.
Exactly. Because I do my podcast, I've kind of stopped doing other people's podcasts and other interviews. So it's been a long while since I talk about any of this stuff. So it does feel kind of... No, it's all good, man.
But yeah, we'll do a label with them. We'll talk about some other stuff after.
So we
talk about the acting.
We kind of had... We had that ignorant outlook that the majors are going to be idiots in suits and the indies are going to be all hip. And it wasn't that case at all. A couple of the majors were coming at me with stuff from the lyrics that were references that no one else had got. They're like, oh, that's a Rakim reference. I'm like, yeah, it is a Rakim reference. Yeah.
Well, I mean, they are music heads. We forget that, innit?
Exactly.
And, I mean, they're probably a bit square now, but they were music heads at one point.
And some of the indies, like one of the indies was like, yeah, we want to kind of make you the new Kano. And it's like, I rate Kano, but I ain't Kano. So it was one of them. I was like,
yeah, I wouldn't place you as the new Kano.
You're this cool indie and you've not got it at all.
And the really weird thing is that that's when Jet Kano probably just first came out. So yeah. They probably didn't need a new Kano
just
yet.
You didn't need a new Kano. I know Kano like, can be slow on his business.
Yeah, yeah,
but,
yeah. But you I don't think we can still have Kano. The old Kano. I think the Kano that is around we
I
still
think
have.
They probably had the Kano and we're getting tired of Kano not being, you know, wanting to come out and gig or do new
not
records.
Being prolific as needed.
But he's a genius. But again, I was like, so the... That was a real kind of shock because we were ready to just hate the majors and love the indies and we didn't. So we started to get courted a bit and one of the first people who played us on the radio was a Rob the Bank. And it booked us a Bestival.
Bestival guy.
And they run a label called Sunday Best. And he was advising us on what was wrong with different contracts that we were getting offered from Warner's, from Sony, from all of these, saying, well, you know, keep an eye on that. That's not right and all that. And then we realised he's the guy we trust. He's got a record label. Let's go with him. So we went with Sunday Best and we turned down some big advances and stuff like that. Again, it's that weird thing in my mind. I don't really... It's an old mentality. I'm not a fan. I always felt advances are kind of preparing to fail. It's kind of going... Let's take the money now because this album's not going to be popular. I'd rather go out there and hustle it. Yeah, I'd rather make an album I'm proud of and go, here you go. Now let's tour it. Let's make it big and earn what it's worth.
I'm not in the music business. So in advance, it's money they're lending you.
They're
just giving you money for now.
It's a complex one. They're lending it to you, but you only have to pay it back through music industry shit, basically.
Okay,
I can swear, right?
Fucking swearing on this cutting podcast.
Through music industry shit. So it might be if you've got a 360 deal that they can recoup it from your gigs, from your merch or whatever else. But if not, it'll be just from album sales. And our Sunday Best one, for example, the advance we got was only recoupable from album sales.
Okay.
And that was the standard
That's
at the
fair.
Time.
Yeah.
And that was fine, and it felt that if we went somewhere that was giving us a smaller advance, then they're gonna, I don't know, it felt like they're gonna have more money to put into making it work and making it right and making it good. They've not spent all the money on our signature on a bit of paper. Do you know what I mean? They can now spend a bit on the artwork, and we always got cool artists to work on our artwork and things like that. So yeah, we did that, and it feels like the right choice. You know, it's weird. I had example on my podcast.
You made a really big transition musically.
Yeah.
And a lot of people kind of forget the fact that he rapped.
Yeah, yeah. And that was it.
He was like a rapper. He was just, sort of in that sort of just
before
level
he went that way, one of the people who approached us were Ministry and they said, we want you to be more like a dancey, poppy dance rap type thing. And again, we're at the point where we're like, our album's almost done and we're really proud of it. Do you want to put it out or not? Like it sounds harsh, but we were like, here's what we are. You can release it if you want. Otherwise, we don't want to have loads of A&R and get changed.
What year are we talking now?
So this was 2005 or 2006, maybe?
So 2005, 2006, who's out now? Is that sort of like dubstep era?
Just before dubstep
era.
Okay,
so
it's when your Ministry's now, we're clambering
for something.
And it was just interesting because it was Ministry who ended up signing Example, and he switched from being a rapper and a comedy rapper and things like that over to that dancing. And for him, it worked brilliantly.
It did work.
But that was it. It was always interesting. At first, I was dead skeptical because I was like, that's what we're trying to get me to do. I ain't into that. But then it was perfect for examples.
You stuck to your music, definitely.
That's it. We stuck to our thing and it kind of, it worked how it worked. But it's an interesting one it's learning curves, isn't it? Like, so, Thou Shalt was our first song. It had no chorus. It wasn't like anything else that was out at that time.
It just worked. Even though it's like, I know everyone's like, that's my favourite song, how you probably, you know, decipher it as someone that's not really a fan.
You
know what I'm saying? Like, but it's like saying, you know, Charming Man is my favourite. Then you're not a fan of the
Smiths. Yeah.
But no, it's just, I don't know why it resonated with me. There's something about... It's just a band.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just a band, and you can idolize all these things, and you can do that. But then you just, it's just a fucking band.
It was completely that. I was writing that. I wrote that because that whole song I wrote in the length of time of the film a 40-year-old virgin. Because Dan emailed me the beat, and then he sat down to watch 40-year-old virgin, and when he finished, just as it finished, an email came through with the vocal. So I'd written it, recorded it in whatever the running time of that film is. But
that's like a 1:30 film. If I'm right, it's like a 1:30. That's a standard comedy with Seth Rogen.
It's
1:30. That's all you need. 1:30.
It's great. But so it was weird. So that worked, and that got in the charts. But it was direct, and I'd written the Just a Band bit because I sat in down the Christmas before and thinking, how mental is it that Tom York is sitting down with his mum and dad around the Christmas table, and his brother's like probably giving him digs and taking a piss and all that. It's like they're all just normal people, and these people that we idolise, they're just people, and that's where the justification
does take out the humanity
from.
Of them, isn't it?
Yeah.
And we kind of see them as these like strange things. I think that's probably why we can why people can be so shitty to them on social media.
Yeah,
because we forget that we're just a person, isn't it? 100%. Even the idolization of it, because we think that they're this separate thing from humanity, so we can be like, "Yeah, you're a cunt."
It's disgusting,
like,
isn't it?
But they're not going to read that and go, "Ah, shit."
I had a guy for years, and I've let it go now. But for years, I remembered his name. He was a journalist, and I remembered his name. I'd looked up a photo of him, and I'd vowed if I ever met him, I was gonna punch him in the face, because I was like, shit was gonna.
I've got
pop
a couple
off.
Of those ones in my notebook.
Because it was one of them though, where it was like. It was just at the start of people not realising that it's the real world. And he'd written an article that said that, or claimed that I was racist. Because someone had asked me my favourite rappers, and at the time it was Sage Francis, and someone like, a couple of people, and he was like, the two or three people I listed were all white. It's like, I could have, depending on the day, I could have been going for KRS and Rakim Sticky Fingers or whoever else.
And plus, you're just picking up your boys,
it's just people
one.
I was into. And that was it. But he'd made this whole thing of racist. And I was like, if I was out and someone started to seriously say I was racist, a discussion would happen. And if it didn't get resolved, it'd kick off. Because I've got black family. I've got many friends who are... black, gay, trans, every race and religion and culture.
You are the type of dude that goes out of his way to try and, you know, to spread the word that, you know, it's a ridiculous ideology.
It's all foolish.
I will say that about
so
you.
It was one of them that it was like, I noted it for ages. Even after I'd stopped being angry, I was like, but people need to, it's important to show people that there's consequences for their actions. And I'm not generally, I'm not some tough guy, hard person, but it was one day where I was like, for ages,
you've got
morally,
that Peaky Blinder haircut.
Exactly. Morally, I was like, I need to spin this lad's jaw because he needs to know that there's real people. I didn't. And I've forgotten his name now, so it's all one of them. It's probably, and to him, it would have been a throwaway thing. It was at the peak of blogging. Coming through and being big, where generally the ones that got a lot of reviews were the people who talk some shit. Or if they gave you a bad review of an album,
who's that one guy? Who, that guy from Black Eyed Peas punched in the face? Who is it?
I don't know.
He went in Big Brother house one time. He's like a quite a camp guy. He does all these really shitty blogs about people.
Yeah, I know the guy.
Blonde hair. You can say, you can speak up.
Perez Hilton.
Perez Hilton. And that guy would talk about your kids.
He wrote about me once.
I was
going out with a girl in LA who was more famous than me and was the type that would get written about.
Okay.
And he wrote about us as soon as we got together. And he didn't write anything bad, but the girl at the time was like, you might want to talk to your PR people and see it. And I was like, I don't want to talk to anyone because this is our private life.
And
I understand. I understand if you're like, if you're someone in that position where it's worth talking to your PR, because not that it's a spin, but it's going to get reported, so you need to take some control. I was like, no, I'm not. That's nothing to do with my PR people. My PR people are in charge of my music, and that's that. That was a weird one. He wrote
it,
again. He didn't say anything shit.
But
it was just
fact
like
that he wrote about
here's this
it.
Guy. He seems all right, and let's hope, because she'd come out of a couple of relationships and was like, and let's hope that this is the one and she's happy and all this. So it was quite positive, but he had previously talked shit about her and talked shit about all people.
I don't understand the fascination of it.
I don't get it, man.
What is the fascination of someone's life? And like, you know, because
it's mad, isn't it?
It is mad. It's just, it's general madness.
But it's mad in every facet of it. I get mad at people who slag off the Kardashians.
Because
it's like, well, they're not for me, but that's fine as well. If you're saying that, oh, all these idiots who want to look like them, it's like, who the fuck are you to call them idiots? If that's their idol, that's their idol. And again, she became famous for a sex tape. Sex is wicked. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that. I don't care if she became famous for a sex tape. It's like, it shouldn't be something that's shamed and put upon.
It's all sex tapes, and you know, because when that era was coming out, it's the one that when people would, when it came out where people were hacking into people's Apples. And
mate.
And I wouldn't look at the photos. People were like, have you seen the photo? Like, no, I haven't fucking seen that stolen photo.
I was the same.
Well, I don't want to see a stolen photo of someone that I don't know naked.
It's madness.
You know what I'm saying? That they don't really know that I could see, you know? Yeah, I'm not saying I've never seen a you know, I had my collection of the Daily Sport. that my mum found one time. But like, it's that weird fascination with fame that I've never, and it's strange that I'm so against it, seeing that I'm in showbiz.
I agree with you, man. And it messes me up. I think the excitement of seeing, you know, a naked selfie or whatever is the fact that person sent it to you because they wanted you to see 100%. It. Not because someone's hacked their phone and they're like, look at this.
I had a
group messages of some dudes I know a while back, and someone shared one of them hacks. And I paused, but then I went in. I said, look, I don't agree with this. I think it's bad.
It's creepy.
It's someone famous. Mm. It's like, that's cool. If again, at that point, I think, say I was single at that point, I could think, I'd like to see her naked at some point. She's well nice. But I'd like her to want me to.
Yeah.
You know, or at least I'd like that to be her choice. Exactly.
I want her to be paid fairly under contract and let me want to see her titties. Yeah.
Completely. And that's the thing. And it's a weird one because it is. It's massive violations.
Did you want to be famous?
Nah. And it's been the really interesting thing of... It's too blunt an answer is no. I like to work hard and to be good at something. The recognition for that feels lovely. That's wicked. I'm not saying, oh, I don't care about that. It's lovely. When you get compliments for stuff, I'm awkward with compliments, but it's lovely. It makes you feel a reward. But it's been the most interesting thing of stopping gigging is I've not missed it at all. And again, I'm sure I'll go back at some point, but it's really made me realise I'm not someone that's ever wanted to be that guy on stage having adoration. I just happened to write some stuff that I was excited to share. As soon as the excitement of sharing that is gone, I have no desire to be there in front of a crowd, and it's like I don't need that. It's why I'm quite a private person, because it's like I'm not...
Are you comfortable with people coming up to you in the street and stuff?
Yeah, I'm fine with all that, because again, it's nice and it's a compliment, and they're generally all right and friendly. I mean, the weird one is always the, are you famous?
Yeah.
Which is a question that answers itself. Apparently not. You wouldn't need to ask that question if it was the case.
It's when they point and go, I know you. I'm like, I don't want to say it, because if I go, oh, is it from that thing? And they go, no, I think you went to school with you. Then I feel like a cunt.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I'm like, I've just assumed that you know that and I've been on telly.
Mate,
like,
I had that early on in Stamford, and it was just after I'd been on Soccer AM and stuff like that.
You must be like a hometown hero.
Weirdly, as soon as I went on Soccer AM, I started to get recognised more, because my area isn't an area for spoken word rap type stuff like that. Do you know what I mean?
It's so, not got a big spoken word scene.
But as soon as I'd got on Soccer AM, they're like, you on Soccer AM, weren't you? And I was walking down the street once and car bibbed, and I was like, and a guy leaned out and went, fucking terrorist. And I was like, oh, mate.
I didn't look like you waved at it.
I was like, and I had another one. I was coming out of a gig and someone went, someone called me. And I was literally, was up Tottenham Court Roadway, near where we are now. It was just before the Astoria closed. And we played a gig downstairs and we're coming out. And some guy grabs me and I'm like, all right, it's going to be a fan. It's after a gig. And he went, fucking Saddam Hussein. And I really wanted to pause and go, I think you mean Bin Laden.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Let's do it correct.
If you're gonna compare me to a terrorist, it's definitely Bin Laden. You're messing this up. But yeah, I also had a really good one. This is just my embarrassing moments now. But I had a really good one where I was at a film premiere. I was going to the premiere of Attack the Block, and Nick Frost is in it, and he's a mate. I'd met him and Simon through the music. I love him, and he'd invited me along, and I'd met a Jonathan Ross once or twice in the comic book store up the road here.
We're both comic book fans
in Forbidden Planet.
Are you a comic book head?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, the
first thing that I released was a graphic novel of poems. I was asked for years to put out.
I have that.
I was asked for years to put out a book of poetry. I was like, I don't read much poetry. I feel like a fraud. So I did a graphic novel. But yeah, anyway, I'd given him a copy of that and all this kind of thing. And we're at this premiere, and Jonathan Ross comes and sits down in front of me with his family. And he turns around and goes, Dan Lesac, good to see ya. And I just went, good to see you, man.
Yeah.
I just went, I was like, I was just about to watch a film. It's all, but he gets it. Yeah. He gets it. It's just.
I remember I was doing these runner gigs in the Middle East. I was eating shit, Pip. I mean, I'm dying at these gigs. And the owner of the club that booked me over there, was there. And he's like he owns like the biggest clubs in England. Yeah. And he didn't. And so he comes up to me and he goes, oh, Jamiroquai. And he didn't know my name. But I know that he was going to call up England and say, don't ever book that guy again. So I just roll it out. So I'm like, yeah. So he's just called back saying, don't book that Jamiroquai. And they're going, all right, whatever.
We weren't going to
buy the figures out of our price range.
Yeah.
But you're a big comic book head.
Yeah, I love it.
What graphic novel do you fuck with? I'm a Garth Ennis dude.
I'm a Garth Ennis dude.
Transmetropolitan, Preacher.
Yep.
I mean, the
Boys is my favourite. The Boys is my favourite book, and then Preacher. So a Transmet is Warren Ellis, not to correct a corrector.
Is he not Garth Ennis wrote that?
It's Warren Ellis.
I'm sorry, I apologise.
But yeah, I'm a fan of both of them. I think Ennis and Ellis are my two that are there. Because the Punisher ones that Garth Ennis did.
They were dope.
The Max, because they had
a couple Max series in there. They had a Wolverine Max one. Yeah. Where it was sort of like Japanese art, where it was sort of like samurai-esque story.
Yeah, yeah.
That was good. They had one with Nick Fury.
Nick Fury, because Garth did that, and that was good as well. Yeah, it was a war one, wasn't it? I had Garth Ennis on my podcast.
Oh, you liar.
And it was mental. It's one of the most nervous I've been, because he doesn't do a lot of interviews. But because Warren Ellis is an Essex boy as well, and I had him on the podcast, I chatted to him, he's amazing.
He's like a futurist.
He hooks me up.
Crazy
shit. Yeah. His mind is. I've had him. I've had Alan Moore.
Yeah.
He was one of my first guests. Who's just legend.
Yeah.
And he hooked me up with Garth Ennis, and Garth came in, and again we talked about Ireland and comics. But then
have you read Crossed?
Yeah.
That was madness. Isn't it? You know, Crossed is the only comic book. And for the people listening, Crossed basically is a zombie. A horror comic,
but far more messed up.
But
if you get the disease, it makes you want to kill and rape.
Yeah, basically,
it heightens the two human instincts of sex and violence.
Yeah, because you're quite still human, but then you just give in to your nastiest inhibitions.
Yeah,
and and it's not the only comic book I've read where I've had to go put that down for a minute.
Yeah,
like it was that dark.
It's heavy, but it was mad because me and Garth were chatting about all this stuff and going back and forth, and then he mentioned a TV. A show called The Shield, which is one of my favourite TV shows of all time. So literally, me and him just went. It would have been infuriating for half of his fans because a big chunk of that podcast is us going off on The Shield, just going like, Vic Mackey is the best character ever. It's amazing, but yeah. So The Boys and Preacher. I read The Boys first. So when I was doing my graphic novel of poems, it got signed by Titan, who did The Watchmen in this country and all things like that. And I'd wanted to do a graphic novel of poems. I'd hit people up on MySpace and Facebook and Twitter. No, it was before I was on Facebook. So MySpace and Twitter at the time. Wow. And people submitted artwork and I put it together. And I got this meeting with Titan and they were ready to be kind of, I'm sure you've got some nice ones from fans, but we'll get some professionals in as well. But I'd printed all of them out, so I'd put it together in what was actually a photo album, but so I had essentially a full book there.
It was ready.
And they loved it. And we didn't have to do any extra ones, and they snapped it up. But when I was going in there, The Boys had just started coming out, and one of the guys who was editing mine kind of said, hey, because it's the thing, you go to record labels not to get a record deal, because anyone who goes in to talk about a record deal, they take you into their little room and go, here's some albums.
Yeah.
And they give you some vinyl, they give you some back catalogue. It's the same with comic books. I'd go in there, I'd plan meetings for nothing of importance at all, and they go, do you want to come out the back and we'll grab you some books? Like, yep. The only reason I'm here, this could have been an email, my friend.
Yeah. You go in there, pitching things you know they don't want.
Yeah, exactly.
Would you ever write a graphic novel? That's something I'm trying to do in the future, is write a graphic novel.
I'd love to. I had an idea, and Garth, Warren Ellis sent me a load of graphic novel scripts to show me how to write them a little bit. And I've not got around to it because I've been writing a lot of TV and film scripts I'm working on. But yeah.
Are you getting into writing the scripts and stuff?
Yeah, I'm loving it. I wrote a TV show that Warp have optioned, and I've got another. I've written a feature and I've got two more kind of film and another TV show that I've
I'm
pitching out there.
That's
and
fucking
that.
Fabulous.
And I love all that stuff. It's being lucky enough again. I'm using lucky again, but to be in a situation to just go after what excites you the most at the time. Do you know what I mean? I could release another album. I'm not excited to. It won't be good. I don't want to soil my back catalogue. Like we were saying earlier, like one of the biggest things I do every month or so, I'll respond to someone who's asking for a new album saying, I need some new music from me. It's like, no, you want some good new music from me. You don't want to churn out a shit album that will make me some money, I'll tour and make some money. But you want some good stuff. And at the moment, I don't feel that's where my good writing is. My good writing is in
TV
and other things. But yeah, I've had a comic book idea for ages that I really want to do. And I've got it all in my head, but...
She's trying to get out there.
It's getting
the
it out there and getting it down. I spoke to... Who was it that hooked me up? Someone hooked me up with one of the head guys at Image.
Oh,
who
Image.
They're the best.
Dude, have you seen an interview with the guy who runs Image?
No, I don't think... It might be who they hooked me up with.
If you meet the guy, he's American, dude. I can't remember. What's his name? I'm going to have to Google it and tell you before we leave here. But this guy... I watched it and I had to show my manager. I was like, you need to watch this guy. He's like, I don't like computers. I said, watch this guy. And the stuff he's saying, man, he's just a boss. And he basically was talking about when he wrote Spawn.
Yeah.
And he's talking about like you know, when he wrote it. And he's just like, he said, you know what? He goes, I don't have any contracts with my drawers or my writers. Yeah. If you don't want to be here, you don't fucking work here. He goes, if you go and give a comic book to him, you own the comic book. He goes, I don't own it. He goes, that's your idea. How am I going to own it?
Dope.
And it's just like, you know, because you know how showbiz is, man.
I run my label.
I've got
no contracts with anyone on my label. Wow. And we've put all these records out, and it's always been.
And your podcast,
the podcast as well, all of it. It's like no contracts and no deals on the label. If you want to go, I'd love it if someone on my label got snapped up by a major. Again, the point of a contract is to stop that happening.
Yeah.
They're stuck with you. It's I'd be. Hype for them. The point of it should be that they're building and going on to bigger things. So I've never had a contract with anyone on the label. It's always just been we've got an idea.
And who've you got signed to the label?
So again, I've got no one signed.
So
we've got Sage Francis and B Dolan and POS, who his album last year. When I did a Ramesh's Hip Hop Saved My Life, one of the albums I picked as my one of my favourite ever hip hop albums is POS's second album. So when he was doing his most recent one, and he hit me up saying, "I've not got a label in the UK. Like, would you be up for releasing it?" I was like, "Yeah."
So you distributed it?
It's brilliant. I distributed it in the UK and got to So POS, an act called a War and Peace, who aren't making anything anymore. A spoken word artist called Polar Bear.
I heard you talk about him. He's like old school. He's original.
He's dope. A guy called Rob Alton, who's a comedian and spoken word artist. He's doing the fringe, he's really good. And a guy called Giacomo Brown, and that's my proudest one, because he's a blues kind of singer. I had to really twist his arm to do an album, because he made some songs. He's no interest in fame. He did two gigs, didn't see the appeal. So he's never done any since.
Didn't see the appeal.
He didn't get it. I don't like that.
Yeah.
So I had to twist his arm. He works in a library and whatever, and he does his thing. He's got no desire to be famous. He wasn't up for doing particularly any interviews or any photo shoots. So I knew, but the album, like the music I'd heard, was amazing. So the beautiful thing there was I knew that if I didn't release it, no one will ever hear that music, because no label wants to sign someone who isn't going to tour it.
Yeah.
Or do interviews. No. He did his two gigs and we released it. It got, I think, an 8 out of 10 in Uncut, which, again, for a debut album to even get covered is huge. It got high scores on Six Music and stuff like that. And we were over the moon.
And what did he say? Was he just shrugging his shoulders?
Yeah, no, he was cool. He's not done any more since. This was literally 8 years ago we put this record out.
Do you know what, though?
Literally 8 years ago. And people hit me up all the time. Is there going to be any more a Giacomo Brown? I'm like, nah. It's not his thing.
He's not into it. That's what I love about you, Pitman, is that you're the only dude I know that would start a record label and sign a dude who's like, nah, I'm done.
It's some songs. Here's some songs. I'll see you later. Cheers, man.
It was like, I got this great album. I'm back to the library.
Yeah.
Fuck it, man. You need some people like that in the world. I love those people in the world, man. The same way I got friends, man, who if they really worked on the craft of comedy, they would blow me out of the water.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They'll blow me out the wall, man. If they really, you know, got the craft of it,
yeah,
they're just that funny naturally. Yeah. They just have they just want to be funny with their mates.
It's interesting, you know? Isn't it? It's the combination of the two. Because I love it and I hate it. I love seeing people succeeding because of their hard work.
Mm.
Like, a podcast I listen to a lot is The Fighter and the Kids. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of
Brendan Schwab.
Yeah. And Brendan is a comedian now and he's doing well. And Joe Rogan always said, like, he used to be an MMA fighter and then he's become a successful comedian. And Rogan always says, it's because he's got the work ethic of an MMA fighter, of a professional athlete. He gets up every day and he drills it and he works on it. And I've not seen any of his comedy. I like his podcast, but I love the fact that he's doing well.
It's
when
not bad. He's not necessarily
the natural comedian that a Rogan or all of these are, but he's got that work ethic. He started far later than everyone else, but he's gone, nah, this is it.
He found a sort of learned notion of it. But I understand why you hate it as well. I mean, it's weird. I mean, like, the friends that I have, I mean, one's upsetting because he's sadly doing a government holiday right now.
Right, yeah.
And
he's
one of the funniest dudes I know. Yeah. And he's got a long time. But
it's killer, isn't it?
Yeah, that one's the only one where I go, fuck, man. I actually took him to one gig as well and he was into it. But, you know, he kind of got scooped up by the other things in life that seemed more appealing at the time.
But it's heartbreaking on every level. Yeah. It can be at that level, or it can just be your mates. I've got tons of mates who've got amazing ideas for scripts, for albums, for all sorts, and they tell me about it all the time. Mm. And then they've got jobs and families and things like that. So it doesn't necessarily progress in there. And that's sad. It's not sad because it's beautiful that they're doing what they're doing. Yeah. I don't believe in the whole idea of fame is above any other.
No, it's only fame, but then also if they've got that idea they want to push out, they should. Yeah. You know, and you find the time. Yeah. I don't know, man.
Well, again, it's just knowing that they could. It's having done it and been there and go, you could do this. Yeah. Again, I still adamantly think I've got a lot of mates who would be better at rapping than me, at writing scripts or whatever else, but I happen to be the one that's done it, that's gone, I'm going to do that, rather than just... a lot of them could do choice. Still and will and things like that. But
I mean, because when people ask me, they go, "How do I get into comedy?" I go, "What you do is the first thing you do is you stop asking.
Yeah, 100%.
You stop asking how you do it, and you go out there and you enjoy the worst decision you ever made in your life.
Yeah,
that's it. There's no middle ground here.
Completely,
you know,
and it's the best lesson I think if you, because you can't teach it. All you can tell people is how you did it, but they're not you.
Yeah, it doesn't work that
And there's going to be some stuff on your path that was wrong.
Yeah.
That was a mistake that you messed up. So they're not learning. And I can completely agree. It's why I don't tend to give any feedback to people on tracks or anything like that. Because, again, I never had that.
What makes you the jump-off dude, though? What makes you the guy who's like, you know what, I'm going to do it? Like, what made you... Was you always like that? Because you're saying you're in your early 20s, you're about to be a manager. And let's be honest, when you're in your early 20s, being a manager somewhere, you go,
it's a big deal,
I'm
man.
Set. That's
real.
Yeah.
Do
you know what I'm saying? You look at it now in your 30s and you go, oh, well, do you know what I'm
100%.
But it was a big
100%
deal.
100%, it is real.
So it's like, you know, what's in you that made you go, you know what? Have you always, was you like that as a youth, or was it just like a decision you had, or was it
an
epiphany?
A weird one.
What is it?
There's kind of two sides to it. I did always have it's going to sound so pretentious or arrogant, but I always had a feeling that I was meant to be doing something.
Mm.
But again, chances are everyone had that. But the other side of it is I grew up in a town that the kind of, you're brought up to want to get the train into London and have a job in London and have an office job and earn good money. And I want that. I literally, genuinely, I've got a picture on my phone. I was clearing out my mum's loft about a month ago and I found a board game that was actually called Commuter. A board game called, and it's about commuting into the city for kids to play. Yeah. And again, I've always, it cracked me up because I said for years that that's the kind of town I lived in.
Mm.
But I don't remember, but to find a board game that literally going, yeah, and you can
so
go.
So when you've gone home.
You can go and live in, you can go and work in the city. It's like, what?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I never wanted to do that. So it was always finding anything that made me not have to do that.
Yeah.
That was the motivation. You could say that they're not wanting to have a real job, but I do get defensive on that because there's not a job I've had that I've worked harder than.
Yeah, that's a hard gig.
Than this career. I've worked in factories, I've worked in delivery, I've worked in shops, all sorts of things, but this is the gig I've worked hardest at. And again, I love it, but like, I in the last 10 years I've had three holidays. Mm. Partly because I love my job, but partly because I am my job. So I can't have a holiday from me. If I go on holiday, I'll be thinking about the work I need to be doing and the stuff I need to write and things like that. So it's a...
People don't realise it's a sacrifice, weird one, man.
Yeah.
Like, I'll be honest with you, man. Like, I can't remember the last time I went to my mum's birthday.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I ain't been to my mum's birthday. I've lost girlfriends. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, it's real, man. Like, people don't understand that it, you know, it comes with a debt. And that, you know, we're not trying to sound like our diamond shoes are too tight. I get to wake up at 12.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's...
For real. It's but, great. You know, again, it is true. I've had that with the one that always comes to mind for me. It proper broke my heart, man. One of my oldest mates from school, Mark Irvine. I love him dearly. We made Mark Irvine Fest the third biggest trending a topic on Twitter.
That's
because
good.
I was doing a gig in Manchester and a kid in the crowd looked like my mate Mark Irvine, and we dubbed it Mark Irvine Fest, and it went crazy. And then I text my mate Mark going, go on Twitter.
Yeah.
I never explained it for like weeks and weeks after. He's like, why is my name trending? And it's Mark with a C as well, so it's a weird name.
Yeah, very specific.
But yeah, he's my boy. And then he met the most amazing girl, and she's wonderful. It's perfect for him. And he excitedly sent me the date of their wedding, and it's best of a weekend. And I'd program the spoken word tent at best of all. It's like, I'm always there and I couldn't make it. And I'll be real, I love missing weddings. Like, that's one of the good things about the industry, is I can say, I can't make it to your shitty wedding. Yeah,
I might be able to pass through the after party for a second, exactly, and I'm going to come in jeans.
But that was the one wedding I'd want to go to, and I wanted to go to, and that broke my heart to get that and be like, oh man, I can't be there, and all of my dear friends are there and seeing. And again, it's not like it's one of them ones where it's your mate and it's like, oh, he's met this girl, she's a bit of a fool, but he's been sucked in. It's like he'd met someone amazing. It was this perfect thing. And I couldn't.
But that's
couldn't
why that's what, that's what separates you, though.
Yeah.
At the same time, it's that thing of, you know, is that you're willing to take it to that next level.
And you're right on you mentioned relationships as well. It is a massive thing there, because again, it's kind of, I purposely didn't have a relationship for years and years and years because I'd still have my fun, but
but you're touring.
Sadly, the fact is, my career is my focus. It's why I've not had kids and don't plan to in the near future, because I couldn't be a good dad at this point because I'm so focused on acting and trying to make this movie industry stuff work or TV industry stuff work. And it was the same with girlfriends for a long while, and there were times I thought, oh, I'll give it a go, and it failed. And you know, that is what it is. It's because of the thing. I'm giving it a go at the moment, and hopefully it won't fail. But
how long have you been with this one?
Coming on for a year, I think.
Okay,
it's
that's
complicated.
Good. Okay.
Again, because there was that period I was just having fun.
Yeah.
Do you know
for
what
her,
I mean?
So for it's, her, it's a year, for you it's 6 months.
Yeah.
I know the ones.
It's a blurred line of where it started and where it began.
She knew she was messing with Pip the player, so what are you going to deal with? I'm already playing with you, brother. But listen, man, I'm going to wrap this up. Quickly, I want to just go into, man. So you got any acting stuff coming up?
I've got a film coming out soon called Kill Ben Like, and I'm in it with Bashy.
Oh, Bashy! Ashley Thomas!
Man. I was excited to work with him, man.
Bashy, do you know what? Bashy was I know you don't like underrated MC.
Dude could spit, and he's an inspiration, man, because a lot of those kids that came up, like him and Ed Skryan are two of my biggest inspirations. Yeah. They were both rapping. They both came up in them kind of, you're just playing yourself as a little street thug films, but then they both went off and made it in different roles. And
Ed Skryne's the man. I met Ed Skryne after I opened for Doc Brown once.
And I
met Ed Skryne, and I'm looking at this, I'm like, I know this dude. And you know, because he's a very particular looking dude. Like, he's very big and handsome looking dude. Yeah. And I know. And I was like, fuck, that's the guy from Game of Thrones.
And then he was on Deadpool.
And he was a lovely dude.
He's top-notch.
I mean, he was a really nice guy, man.
He's one of my
you know,
favourite people
really
in the
nice
world.
Really nice guy. He was cool. I might try and get him on the podcast, but yeah.
Me and him took his son swimming. And when we got there, Doc Brown was just leaving with his daughter. So again, it's weird how these people just stay in the same areas and circles. Like, they're all doing different things now.
That's beautiful. Something beautiful in that. But
So Kill Ben Like, it's this Kill weird like. Kind of, it's a murder mystery, but it's kind of a comedy. And it was good fun. It's got my boy Eugene, who was in Game of Thrones. He was the guy who had the thing on his head.
Cousin
of the Starks and all that kind of thing. Or not Starks, the other ones.
Yeah, the other
ones.
Pricks.
the gold ones. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And, yeah. And you do, and you're in Walk Like a Panther with my boy Gus Khan.
And Walk Like a Panther. I need to watch it. Graham. And I mean, with Dave Johns, everyone, all these comedians.
I know Dave. I gig with Dave a few times. I like Dave. And Gus is the man. Gus is my boy.
Yeah,
I need to get Guz on the podcast. But you trying to get Guz in one place.
Man,
it's a motherfucker trying to get Guz somewhere,
it's
boy.
It's a thing. I was booking him. In fact, it was when Man Like Mobium came out. And again, it's what I was saying to you. I love it when I get hit up by the people of my boys. Because with Guz in particular, I was like, that means I know he'll be there. Because again, if I'd just tried to arrange it directly with Guz, it wasn't happening. But because his people had said, well, we've got him in a meeting here and then we're putting him in a car here.
Yeah.
And we're doing this, I was like, it'll be there then. It'll be all right. But
I'm trying to get Guz now for something. We're trying to raise some dates together. Look, I'm not going to be doing. I'm touring this year.
Yeah.
And me and Guz were talking about it, and we're trying to do some live dates together.
Be dope. Yeah.
Yeah, we're trying to do some stand up together. Cause we need to do that. Cause I ain't worked with Guz yet. But we're gonna wrap this up. And I just want to say thank you, Pip.
Thank you.
And I really appreciate it, man. And you know what, man? Like, you know, it's when I started, when I said I'm doing this podcast, the first name I said is I need to get Scroobius Pip on this.
That's dope, man. I'm loving the people that you're getting. Like, want to hear or just seeing what I've not heard of him because we recorded this before they're out, but. A Grace Neutral is someone who I think is dope, and I haven't heard enough from. I've seen a few little clips, and the people just do nothing, boys, and all that kind of.
Yeah, we got some good people coming on, and but I really appreciate it, man, and I have nothing but respect for your work ethic. I think you're a go getter, and you get out and you get it.
Thank you.
And
man.
There's because you know in life there's so many people who they want to do things and they don't.
Yeah.
And you ain't one of them people. And, you know, it's definitely influenced me. And I don't say that a lot, but, it has, you know, especially with my work ethic.
Yeah.
Because there's certain things in my career that I'm not happy with. And I'm like, you know what, man, I need to do me a scrupulous pip.
Yeah.
And take some ownership about my own actions.
I love it.
You know what I'm saying? What I call it now. If I do sign that I own, that's a scrupulous pip.
Damn right. I'm feeling it. I like it.
All right, my brother. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Look forward to it, bro. Peace.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It's great fun.
Thank you, Pip.
Cheers, brother.
Appreciate you, man. We'll be right back.